When you're working in Hollywood, if you're a creative person, you have a product. It's not called show play, show dancing, or whatever. It's called show business.
And we would not have a marriage today if we did not have Jesus Christ in our life.
Is this a lucrative career? Because, I mean, after all, the channel's called the Seven Figure Squad.
If you get into the right situation, you make a show, and it's doing great. You definitely see some money you've probably never seen in your life. Never short, but now I'm winning like I'm Jada. Steady through the rigor.
So my guest today is best known for creating Nickelodeon's The Fairly Odd Parents, Danny Phantom, Tough Puppy, and Bunsen is a beast. And I was asking my daughters this morning, hey girls, do you remember The Fairly Odd Parents? They're like, yeah, Puppy, we love that. Well, guess what? I'm having an opportunity to talk to the creator and animator of that. Like, I can't wait to see it. My daughters are 20 years old. So
they're the perfect age.
It's a perfect
day. They're right here. So welcome to the Seven Figure Squad.
Well, thank you very much, Matt. We're honored to be here. And we just recently discovered you guys. And I wish I could say we've known about you for years. But Julianne, my beautiful wife here, she saw an interview you did.
I have to say how it happened. Do you mind? Can I tell them?
Please, please.
Okay, so I wear my phone on like a strap. And
this drives me insane.
Yeah, he doesn't like it. But anyway, so it never leaves my body, right? And so I was just like turning a corner and the phone kind of went out from me and then it hit something, the counter or something. I was listening to a YouTube channel and all of a sudden it just switched and I'm like, what was that? And I look up and it's you. And I'm like, well, who's this guy? Right. But something just told me to listen.
But you were interviewing Daniel Kwok.
Yeah. Yes,
Daniel Kwok.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. And
I loved it, so I sent it to him.
And I listened to it, and I'm like, first of all, who's the guy this guy's interviewing, and who's this interviewer, guys? So I just left a comment on the video.
Yeah, hey, who are you guys?
I'd love to meet you guys, and that's how we got connected. So, yeah, that's the internet age for you.
If I'm asked, I mean, what was your takeaway? What gravitated to you both about the conversation?
The main thing I took away was Daniel, first of all, you're a great interviewer, which I loved. You know, very professional, thought you guys were great. And I checked out your channel. I love what you guys talk about success and all. I love that. And but Daniel's story was so moving to me. How he was a young Korean boy. They were very poor. They believed in Jesus, but they were very poor. And he was wondering, why am I poor when I believe in the Lord? And then he learned how to utilize the fact he wanted to make that wasn't wrong to want to be successful as a Christian. And that's what I really took away. And then the fact that he's so successful as a result was really,
and,
really
and cool. Also, you know, it's not just, he's not just like a Christian in name and neither are you.
No,
you
that was evident really by the conversation. Yeah.
Yeah. Like you really are. I call them, there's Christians and then there's believers. And you guys are believers. And so I believe that, you know, that was definitely. And then, of course, the story about the flowers, that just makes you want to cry. When he said that his mother was picking flowers and he thought it was for like a nice decoration on the table, but it was dinner. I'm
that's how poor they
were. I wish. And I think, were they out here in
Chicago? Chicago?
They were in Chicago. I'm like, God, I wish I would have met them, you know. 20 years ago.
I want to remind you to heap onto the story. It snows in Chicago.
Yes.
So it's very cold.
California, not so bad, but in Chicago, just awful. And it just reminds me, I'm on the board of a homeless center here in California. And, you know, not everybody thinks, you know, that homeless people or people sleeping in their cars, you know, they've lost their mind, they're crazy. Well, that's not always the case. And he is a perfect example of why we go out and we try to help everybody that we can.
Yeah.
Gotcha. You know, I'm also intrigued also because Butch, I mean, it's like, you're no slouch on YouTube either. You got close to 900,000 subs on your,
on my YouTube channel. Yeah, that's been a blast. We've had such a great time. And but I'll tell you, as you well know, YouTube is a grind. YouTube is work. when you do it for real, it's a legit thing. And if you want to get out there and be successful with YouTube, you've really got to work it. I mean, I was fortunate. I had a little bit of a name and a little bit of following when I started in 2015. In fact, my daughter, Carly, she was like, we should get you on YouTube. And I went, okay. And I didn't really care. We did a couple of videos and started seeing some traction. And then I did a video, Danny Phantom, 10 years later. I just drew the characters as if they were 10 years older, and it got like 3 million views. And I went, whoa, maybe there's something here. So we just started having a good time. And but yeah, it is, it's a blast. We have a good time doing it. I love social media. I love doing it. And I think it's a great way to keep in touch with the fans, you know.
But he really does love doing it. He doesn't really want anybody else doing it for him. So, you know, a lot of people have the team. Well, a lot of stuff Butch does himself, because he wants the fans to know that he wants them to hear his voice and not someone else's voice.
But Butch, I want to ask you, you know, of course, I just love this dynamic between the two of you. My wife and I work together in business. There's a lot of successful companies in our business that are couples running offices from all across the country. And I think that, sadly, I think many people in America today, because of decision to be in careers, individual careers, they end up growing apart versus finding a way to grow together. And of course, you know, the proverb, you know, there's nothing more powerful than a three-corded rope that's woven together. And it just excites me to see more and more examples, and yourself setting an example of a husband and wife working together. Butch, I wanted to ask you this question. You know, when did you realize you were creative? When did you realize you were good at art? When did you realize, man, I can freaking draw, man. I'm good at this thing.
Oh, you know, I grew up in Michigan. I was born in Highland Park, Michigan. Growing up as a kid, I remember being in kindergarten. I never forget the day. It's really weird. I was like 5 years old, and the teacher in kindergarten asked us, all the kids, to draw a picture of her. Everyone draw a picture of me. I drew a picture, didn't think twice about it. And then the teacher starts raving about this picture. I'm like, God, this is the best picture. And she kind of humiliated all the other kids because she hung my picture up on the wall. Look how good this is, and all this other stuff. And I remember her going down the hall and saying, look how good this is, to these other teachers. And I'm like, as a kid, you're like, wow, I could get attention from adults if I draw pictures, you know? And so I thought, okay, maybe there's something to this. And so I just kept drawing and drawing. And I just fell in love with cartoons, because when I was a kid growing up, maybe you had the same experience. On Saturday morning, it's the only place you could see cartoons, you know? So I would watch cartoons. And Super Friends. Oh, yeah, absolutely. You know, and Scooby-Doo and Bugs Bunny and everybody. So just loved cartoons, and just started really getting into it as a kid. And even at that early age, I don't think I knew what I was doing, but I wanted to hang out with other people who did what I did. I wanted to hang out with other cartoonists. And that's what everybody does. If you're into baseball, you hang out with baseball players or whatever. Sure. I hang out with other nerd cartoonists when being a nerd wasn't cool, you know? And so I just love drawing cartoons. I loved watching anime back then, but very early anime. I loved Disney movies and all that stuff. And so I just wanted to learn. And then I ended up going to, I found out about a school in California, this magical land of California, a school called Cal Arts, and it was founded by Walt Disney. And I went there in 1983 to study animation. That's how I got to California.
Great. From Michigan to California.
From Michigan, yeah.
Gotcha. And we were talking when I was dropping off my son at the airport, how you both met. So, Julianne, when did you realize you're a good comic? When did you realize you were funny?
I never really thought I was funny.
She just wasn't afraid to be on stage.
Yes. Right. So this is all BC, before Christ. So I worked on the game show Jeopardy for 15 years. And back in 1984, Alex Trebek was, you know, the host, of course, but he also was the producer. And so he had hired me. And I had a girlfriend.
Her hair was up to here.
The 80s hair. You know.
Big hair, Aquanet, you know.
Oh, dude. Oh,
yeah. You know what? I didn't need Aquanet because my hair is naturally curly. I just straightened it today. But anyway, so I had a girlfriend that was so supportive. She was like the head researcher. And the writing department. And so she was so supportive of my acting career, because that's really what I wanted to do. And I, you know, I did Jeopardy as my day job, you know, to pay my bills. And so she just one day she says to me, she goes, you know, you really do good with immediate response, because I would do some theater. And she goes, I think you should do stand-up comedy. I'm like, well, I'm not even funny. Like, who would listen to me? So she found this woman Judy Carter, to teach how to do stand-up comedy. And I took a class. And the last class was, we would go on stage at a club here.
Like the final exam, you do 6 weeks of the class, and your final exam was performing at a club. And that was your final exam.
And so I was going up, and Butch was there to see a friend of his that was right before me.
And I saw her perform and thought she was pretty. Anyway, long story short,
I don't think it was the comedy at all. You know, again, BC, I dressed a little differently back then. I'm sure that was the attraction.
No, that would never be. No, I would never.
But I ended up doing the class. I did the class again because I needed to get more minutes. And so
I enrolled in the class. After
somebody
that.
Showed up in the class.
So we met in a stand-up comedy class, if you can believe it, back in 1990.
Look at that.
We've been married. We've been married for 29 years now. As of this recording, it's been 29 years.
It's interesting because you know your work, and it's not only you're a good animator, not only a good you not only draw well, but you're funny. You know, there's humor behind all these things. The way you do your videos, it engages so many different broad classification of people. So when I'm seeing somebody that's been in the game for 20, 30 years. Mm-hmm. You know, and especially in this world today, what is your opinion? Because so many people today, because of social media, because of they see a success story like your work, and they want success right away. They have an instant gratification type of mentality. Mm-hmm. What's your opinion? What's your reaction to them when they say, "Man, Butch, you know, I want this in my life right away. I want instant success. I'm not getting it in the last 1, 2, 3 years. What's my problem?"
And see the world, our mindset, we want to get in there and just do it right away and just start. Normally that way lies madness. That's the part where you're going to get hurt because you're not ready for it, you know, and our God loves us. Jesus loves us so much. He's going to prepare us. So that journey that you're on is not there to frustrate you. It's there to prepare you. And so the journey that you're on right now, if you're 20, 30 years old, listen to this, you want to get in the animation industry, all the work you're doing now, all the connections you're making, they're going to amount to something eventually. Don't ever look on your experience as a bad experience, because it's only an experience. It's a learning process.
It's a journey.
Totally a journey. And I always say this, things that affect you instantly aren't really good for you. Drugs, things like that, that happen instantly to you, they're not good for you. It's going to the gym. It's building up your body. You can't lift 100 pounds when you first walk into the gym. You got to lift 5 pounds, 20 pounds. And then you're going to get to the point you can lift more. You know, you can't run a TV show until you've worked on a TV show. You need to know how things work. You need to know how to get how to manage people and how to be a boss. When I got my first cartoon show, I was blessed. It's a blessing. I was so excited. But I had been in the industry for almost 20 years at that time. Then I got a show. And by that point, I knew how to run a show. I could do every piece of the show on my own. That's when I was finally able to get it, when I was ready for it. You know, George Burns has a great quote. He says, "What you're ready for usually shows up." And being ready for something is imperative.
You know, and let's face it, you know, this business is really based a lot on reputation. Mm. And so when you've come into something like that too soon, that could be a very big detriment to your reputation.
Yeah. And
so
if you're not ready for it and you blow it at an early age, it's very hard to dig yourself out of that, which is why I caution people, prepare, get ready, learn. And that's the key. Right?
Well, and think about it. Studios are investing in the person. Mm-hmm. Right. And so if that person isn't ready yet, you know, that could be a big problem. But what we always tell people to do is start on YouTube, start building some of your, whether you want to be on camera or you want to create, mm-hmm. start doing something like that. YouTube, TikTok, get used to putting yourself out there, because that in itself sometimes can be kind of scary when you're putting your heart, your work out into the public, for instance, where people can actually tear it apart.
You know, right. And I wrote a book called Mad Hustle. And should I plug the book? Like I got the
you
book.
You did. Do you have it right next to you?
Do I happen to have the book right next to me?
Wait, no way.
Boom.
Anyway, no, my book is called Mad Hustle, and it's all about how to pitch and sell shows in Hollywood.
Oh, perfect.
And the reason I wrote it, I get this question all the time. How do I pitch a show? What do I do? And this book is all about the mistakes and the pitfalls I went through, so you won't have to go through them. And one of the first things I talk about is preparation, number one. And one thing I talk about that people really are blown away, I talk about is partnerships and contracts. And when you're working with other people, how imperative it is to have a written agreement between the two of you. Because when money starts showing up, friendships change very, very quickly. Wow. And it's like, you better have an agreement. Well, it's my brother. He would never be mean to me. Let me tell you something. When a check shows up and you're going to divide it, you got to have an understanding of who is going to get what and how, you know, if creating a show, especially, it's a very tricky thing because
especially when someone says, you know, well, oh, I'll just draw your, you know, some of your
characters
or something, and you think, oh my gosh, that's so sweet of you, he wants to help me out. Well, now the show gets picked up by Fox. That guy's coming with his hand out going, where's my money?
Oh he's also going, I get part of the show, right? I drew those drawings, because you wouldn't, you know, if you don't pay somebody up front, they can then lay claim to your product.
And have so it's, a contract.
Yeah, we want people to be very, very cautious as to how they go about this. So it's not just about drawing cartoons. There's a whole business side to it too.
And we've seen it all. Unfortunately, we get a lot of people, well, we experienced it, but also we get a lot of people coming to us and saying, why didn't I do a contract? I can't believe that's right.
Yeah.
You know, we do contracts for everything.
Without naming names or networks or shows, give me a horror story. Give me a kind of what's a horror
story? I have a story. I do have a story. It was an early story. It happened to be very early in my career. And
Hanna-Barbera or at
I was in Hanna-Barbera. Yep, yep. And I'm with and Hanna-Barbera was actually taking pitches. We were going to pitch a show, and a friend of mine had an idea. It was a really good idea. He asked me to come and help him develop the idea, so I did. And we worked on it for a little while. And then he said, hey, I'm bringing this friend of mine to lunch with us. And I went, great, no problem. And we all sat around and we had the show, the two of us, but this friend was there and he threw like one teeny little idea in, like, you should make the character's hat red. Oh, that's cool. Great. Guess what? For the rest of the existence of that show, the friend who went to lunch was suddenly part of the team. And I got a third of everything, was in every contract, was in every meeting, and yeah. Was like, wow, I learned that one very quickly. I was like, can't do that again. So, yeah.
So you just have to be careful who gets put into a...
Because I want to say this too. Yeah. When you're working in Hollywood or in entertainment at all, if you're a creative person, you have a product. If you're an actor, you're the product. If you're pitching a cartoon idea, that's the product. Because it's called show what? Show business. It's what it's called. It's not called show play, show dancing or whatever. It's called show business. And so if you want to be serious about this and make a living doing what you love, you need to take it seriously. And then the book I wrote will help. And there's other books too. But I walk you through a lot of the steps I went through and some of the mistakes I made. So check it out if you can.
You know, experience does not have to be your best teacher. You can learn from someone else's mistakes.
That's right. Yeah. So learn from my mistakes.
It can save you some time.
Seeking wisdom right there. That's seeking wisdom, right? That's
amen. Awesome. No, yeah. Absolutely.
Julie, I want to ask you, how do you and Butch work together? What's your guys' working arrangement? I mean, I see you. You're very smart. You're very intelligent. You're in there. It doesn't seem like anybody can push anything over in on you.
Well,
you're savvy. So how do you work? How do you and your husband work together?
Well, I'm his biggest fan, so I'm always protecting him. And so, you know, Butch he's so much into the creative part, and I've always been on the business side of things. And so that's how we really integrate really well. Like, for instance, when we create a show, like we've got a children's show right now. It's not cartoons, it's live action.
And it's not out there yet. We're still working on it.
It's amazing. But anyway, you know, it's like the writing part of it, that's not me. Like I'm not even going to go in there. You know, when he's in the studio directing, it's not my place either. Everything else, yes, you know, to make sure that, you know, schedules are on time and production,
paying people, contracts, and all that other stuff.
So when you know your lane, when you know where you should be, you know, it's like women, sometimes we tend to try to micromanage our husbands with everything.
No, no, never. That would never happen. That would never.
But when you do that, and especially with someone that's super creative, what I love is when he's around his own kind, you're like, my God, he is just a kid. Like he really is in his heart.
Yeah.
You know, but I think that's why we integrate so well. And you know, the main thing is that we both love Jesus, and we would not have a marriage today if we did not have Jesus Christ in our life.
No, Christ is definitely the cornerstone and the center of our life. You talked about the three stranded cord.
Yeah.
It's her and I and Christ right in the center. And you know, could we have done things in Hollywood without Christ? Absolutely. People do it all the time. But we feel we do it better with Christ because he's taken us places that we could never have found on our own. And I'm dead serious about that. And you know, there's ideas I've gotten that I never would have gotten before. There's connections I've gotten that I would never, but also he's just shown us how to involve people and involve ourselves in projects we never would have thought about on our own. And that's what I love.
You know, it's interesting too, because this is years ago, we would always get this phone call from his agent, you know, well, you know, that production company said, we don't know why we're doing this contract. We've never done it like this for anybody else, but we're going to do it for Butch. Mm-hmm. Those kind of things, we know that was God opening up doors. And, you know, and we just know it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I love it.
Many times that conversation would happen.
You know, Proverbs 3:5 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart, lean not on your own understanding. So my understanding is very limited. I have zero understanding, but there's things that happen in my career and things that are continuing to happen in my career that, you know, you're like, well, Lord, let's see. And listen, this isn't us taking our hands off the wheel like this. That's not what it's all about. You know, Deuteronomy says in chapter 8:18 says, I give you the power to get wealth. I don't give you the wealth. I give you the power to get it. So we all have, all of us, everybody watching has the power to get it. Where do you get it? And I have another question for people. Who are you listening to? I ask everybody out there, who are you listening to today? Are you listening to yourself? Are you listening to your best friend, your mom, your dad, Jesus? I mean, who are you listening to?
You know, Butch, it's only recently that you've left Nickelodeon and you're now doing your thing. But what's the benefit? Because oftentimes, as you know, back to my earlier thoughts about instant gratification, what would the benefit be for you, for a new animator, a new creator, a new person in show business, a new people, a new entrepreneur looking to develop the product? What was the benefit for you working in a context like a Hanna-Barbera, and a Nickelodeon? What was the benefit of you rising up in that infrastructure, learning the game on somebody else's dime before you branched off later on as recently into your own game?
Amen. Well, the main thing you said was somebody else's dime. That really helped. Somebody was paying, but somebody was paying me. Well, listen, when you're young and you want to do anything, whether it's sports, whether it's music, whether it's animation, I mean, I wanted to be, how weird is this? I wanted to be an animator. You talk about a specific niche. I wanted to be a cartoonist animator who worked for Walt Disney. That's all I wanted to be. I didn't want to be like, you know, an opera singer or whatever. I wanted to be, you know, this very specific niche, and it's very competitive. Fortunately, I was young and dumb enough not to realize how competitive it was, but I was very confident in myself. I was very confident. I went for it. But I think it's very beneficial to work for someone for a while and learn how they do it. You know, I think everybody you've ever talked to that's successful says, you want to be successful, hang out with successful people. Like, I got hired by Hanna-Barbera, the studio I used to watch growing up as a kid. Yes. Now I'm working there. So, you know, I got a job there. So it's like, wow. But while I was there, I met all the guys who made all my favorite cartoons. There's a guy down the hall who drew the Flintstones. There's a guy over there who drew Scooby-Doo. Let's go to lunch. Let's talk. Let's learn. Yeah. And what I learned about a lot of these guys, and this is no offense to these guys and ladies, they were workers. They did their thing. They worked for somebody. Like, I worked for this studio. And that's kind of the mentality of a lot of people in Hollywood. I worked for this studio. I've always had a mentality of, I work here, but I have other plans. I want to have my own thing eventually. I want to do my own studio someday. Yeah. And I was at Nickelodeon. I love Nickelodeon. We had such a great time there and they treated me so well. But after 20 years, I was there for 20 years. That's a lifetime. Yeah. And I had such a great time there.
That's with my career. How old is daughter?
His daughter's 20. I was there your daughter's whole life. My daughter, I have two daughters.
Who watched Fairly Odd Parents all the time.
I know. But after 20 years of being at a place, I was like, I just really started feeling it's time to go do my own thing now. And that's what we wanted. We really felt led in our hearts to start our own streaming service. And we're going to be starting our own streaming service very soon. We've been working on it for 3 years. Yeah. It's one of those things we wanted it to happen right away. But we really had to get prepared for this and meet people and learn how to do this. And not just work for a company, but starting a company. Yeah. And that's a whole different ball of wax.
Well, I think the pandemic showed that streaming services work quite well.
There's definitely a market for it, for sure.
You know, I want to add to what he was saying is that, you know, working for these production companies, that it's really important that you understand, like, the daily routine. Like, how do you get a show on the air? Like, how does it happen?
Yeah.
A lot of people come to us and they've got other jobs in other industries and they want to walk in and pitch a show and sell it, but they've never been in any production studio, whether it's live action or animation. So I really believe that it's important that whether you do an internship, you do something, but you make all the copies or something, I don't know. But it's really important that I believe that you should get into a studio, see what it's like, see how the production goes and see how you don't want to do things or see how you do want to do things. But to just, you know, just roll in and want to sell a show in an industry that you know nothing about is very hard to do. And so my suggestion for someone is to get a job working in an animation, if we're talking just specifically right now, animation, get in that studio, start seeing how it works, be in that creative environment. And it's so creative. You know, it's like a Nickelodeon, every section would be like there was Dora the Explorer section. It was so
cute. The SpongeBob section.
The SpongeBob section. You know, then there was Fairly Odd Parent. It was just so fun to see all the colors and all the characters, you know, on this, you know, hanging from the ceilings, on the walls.
But it, none of it happens without a business mentality behind it. You know, and
just
I know
creative,
you know,
just be creative without actually executing and having a result.
Exactly. And it breaks my heart when I meet people that really want to do something creative, but they don't have the first step to it. You know, we coach a lot of people and we offer that as well. But like how to break in. I can never guarantee anything, but I can definitely give you the steps to get to the gate. I can take you up to the gate for sure. You know, in fact, there's a lot less. It's funny. Before the internet, the gates were much bigger. There was like several studios and that was it. And you had to get through that gate to get in. But now with the internet, with YouTube and TikTok and all the social media, there's ways to get an audience that didn't exist before. And so that's, I encourage everybody out there with your cell phone, which is your movie studio in your hand, start making some movies, start making some content and get good at it. Yeah.
Before I got some questions here about faith-based implementation into our daily lives. But one thing I'm very, very curious about in terms of your daily life is what does it really take to, let's say your show gets picked up. Okay. All right. Awesome. We got a job now. We have a season. What is that? What is that? What are those steps? Okay. Now you got this step. What are those steps and what do you have to worry about on a daily basis? Because I think at one time you had two shows going on and you're storyboarding and creating and writing and all this.
Oh yeah.
What are the,
let me say one thing before you even go to the job. If you are married, you need to have a wife or a husband, whichever one isn't, you know, at the studio, making sure that things are running smooth at home. Wow. Because when you're like, when he goes to work, I don't want him going with all this, you know, drama in his head, trying to run his shows and then be so concerned and worry about what was going on at home. And then when he had the two shows running, it wasn't like he didn't talk to us. My husband and I talk on the phone 20 times a day. We always have, you know, so we've always been like that, but he was never too busy to not spend time with me and the girls, but making sure though, that the wife or the husband, like I said, whoever is at home is the one that is making sure that things are organized and in place so that he can go do, or she can go do her creative thing. Now you can take it from there for when you get to the office.
Beautiful input.
Well done. No, I will encapsulate this as quickly as I can because it's a very long answer. But when you sell a show, you suddenly, if you want to just draw cartoons all day, that's going to vanish because you no longer are the cartoon drawer. You're the boss now. So you've got to make sure the writers are doing their job writing scripts. Well, by the way, the script just doesn't have to be done. It has to be good. That's script number one. Then once that script is done, that goes to the storyboarders. Then you got to oversee the storyboard to make sure that's good. That's about 300 panels to make sure that all works together. So the narrative is good because when it gets on television, someone's going to be watching it. When it's out of your hands, you can't change it anymore. So you've got all that time to control the script, the storyboard, the voice actors, casting your voices, directing. I did all the directing of all the voices. I cast all the shows. I did some voices myself, but I would oversee the storyboards. I had an amazing staff, by the way. None of this happened without my incredible staff. I had some incredible people working for me and with me for years and years. I got to get my hat off to them. Movie TV creation is not a one person job ever. You ever sit through a movie and see that list of credits that goes up at the end? There's a million people. And then you have to make sure the music is good. The editing is good. And that's just one show. That show goes out the door. Then there's show number two. And then the one thing you deal with a lot, and I encourage people to learn how to do this, is you deal with people all day long. You're dealing with people's attitudes, their personalities, their issues, their likes, their dislikes, their wants, their needs, all this stuff. So as a boss, as a showrunner, you've got to make sure your little kingdom is running fine so the show can move forward. Show's a hit, everybody wins. You know, show not doing good, ratings not doing good, everybody gets nervous, everybody starts freaking out.
Find another job.
Yeah, it's very dicey. And then when I was doing Fairly Odd Parents and Danny Phantom at the same time, I had to double all that at the same time. We had two shows at the same time. And I was really blessed. Fairly Odd Parents ran for 18 years nonstop from 2001 to 2018 or 17 years. It ran for, and I was just so blessed and had such a great time. And I called Fairly Odd Parents the train. The other shows would hop on and hop off. You know, Danny Phantom came, Tough Puppy came, Bunsen came. And then selling those shows, developing a show at the same time you're making one and come up with a whole new cast of characters. I've pitched more shows than I've sold. There's like four that got on the air, but there's about 80 that didn't get on the air.
Wow. Yeah. So nobody ever talks about those 70s.
They don't talk about those.
Nope.
Right? So just like anything else. Yeah, so you were talking about checks earlier. I mean, is this a lucrative career? Is this something that if there's a kid out there is watching this, he's very good at drawing and he's great at animation, anime, and he's excited about it. I mean, can you make, because I mean, after all, the channel's called the Seven Figure Squad YouTube channel.
Well, no, listen, if you play your cards right and it's all about timing. If you get into the right situation where you make a show, it gets on the air and it's doing great, you are definitely going to see some, you'll definitely see some money you've probably never seen in your life. Even getting a job in Hollywood, period.
Yeah.
If you're from the Midwest or from any other part of the country, really, except for like New York, you come to like LA and you get a job in entertainment, you're going to see some pretty serious money no matter what you work in, no matter what part of the industry you work in. Right. However, cost of living is a lot higher out here as well. Sure. In California. But no, you'll definitely, if you check all the boxes right and you are able to sell a show, you definitely will see some really Absolutely. Nice financial gains. But then it's, you got to play it smart. See, I have her on my side. She's the one behind the scenes with the bat cave with all the monitors doing the charts and the figures. Okay, we have this, we need to be wise. And you know, and by the way, your show is only going to go so long. I was very blessed to have a show go for 17 years. Your show might come on. My show, Bunsen is a Beast, only ran for one season. You know, so shows come and they go, and then you're back to square one again. So that's the trick. That's the trade-off.
That's one thing about our industry. And even like at Jeopardy, as everybody knows, Jeopardy is still on the air.
Yeah, that's a rare one.
Yeah, and we brought it back, or they brought it back in 1984, and it's been going since.
Yeah.
And so that is just always, he always was watching out for me and always protecting me, because our industry, you know, you'll work for a couple of weeks and then you got to go find another job. I never had to do that. Yeah. Never.
It's rare. If you get on a job like that, if you get on a situation where, one second, if you get in a situation where you are, we're back. If you get in a situation where you're on a show, make sure it's a show that's going to last for a while, and know that, you know, there's a steady paycheck coming. I always tell people, if they write a, people love, people, everybody out here wants to write a screenplay. I want to write a movie. I go, that's awesome. Don't quit your day job when you sell that movie, because you'll sell the movie, but they don't pay you right up front for the movie. They pay you a little bit. They pay you in installments for a movie, and the movie might take 3 or 4 years to get paid. And then sometimes the movie doesn't even get made, you know, and so that's a whole different thing.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Okay. But what's it, the best case scenario though, then there's the residual income aspect of it.
Oh yeah.
Oh no, the best case, let's just point to SpongeBob for a second. SpongeBob, for example, the guy who created SpongeBob, rest his soul, Steven Hillenburg, what a wonderful guy. He created a show, Little Sponge Lives Underwater. It just hit all the right buttons. Biggest show in the world. Merchandise went through the roof. And that's the golden child. You're like, wow. The next SpongeBob. Whereas Fairly Odd Parents, we did amazing everywhere. We did amazing with merchandise, everything, but not as well as SpongeBob did. You know, I always say SpongeBob is the Mickey Mouse. I was kind of the Donald Duck of of Nickelodeon. You know, I'll take Donald Duck any day of the week. But nothing wrong with Donald. But there's not always a Michael Jordan. There's some great players on the team, and everybody's Michael Jordan. But you got to be, like, just get in the NBA. You got to be amazing to get in the NBA.
Yeah.
But not everybody's Michael Jordan, you know, not everybody's SpongeBob. It's a whole different thing.
You know, I talk about money and success, prosperity, you know, elevating your game all the time on our YouTube channel. And one of the biggest pushbacks I get, and I've been wrestling with this word, maybe you can help me understand it better, is that oftentimes I get our Christians, not necessarily believers, as you're put there, throw scripture at us here on our YouTube channel talking about, you shouldn't go after becoming wealthy. You shouldn't come after becoming rich. You shouldn't go after, you know, getting the next promotion. Just be content with whatever God gives you. Mm-hmm. I just can't see a Butch Hartman just being content just with one, you know, project at Hanna-Barbera, one project at Nickelodeon.
Well, first of all.
We both have answers for that. Yeah, so I'm glad you asked that.
Let me tell you something. The most amazing day ever is when you can give people cars. Houses,
or pay their rent.
Pay their rent. pay for their schooling. Mm-hmm. You see, the problem is they're thinking about it's all for them and how many cars they can have and how many houses they can have. Mm-hmm. You know what? That's your business. You can do what you want with it. But for us, we make money to help people. Mm-hmm. And when we met Jesus in 1999, we at that point said, we are going to be givers. We're going to sow like no one's ever seen before.
Yeah. When you see what someone's getting, you need to take a look at what they're given. I always say, you know, the Bible says you reap what you sow, and you're not going to reap anything if you don't sow anything. I want to talk about real quick the story of the Good Samaritan. The Good Samaritan finds a man laying beaten on the road. There's a man who's been attacked by bandits laying on the road. Two people pass him. I think a priest and a rabbi pass him, but the Good Samaritan comes along, picks the guy up, puts him on his donkey, so he had a vehicle, gives him oil and wine, so he had medicine, takes him to an inn, so he had connections, pays for his stay at the inn, so he had money to pay. And then he says, I have to go. Here's money. Whatever he needs, I'm covering it, but I got to go. So the Good Samaritan had business to attend to, and then he came back and picked the guy up. So see, Christians need resources. If you don't have resources, you won't be able to be effective in any way at all. Yes, you can pray for people. I'm not saying you can't be effective completely, but it's the notion and the myth that we're not supposed to have resources or be prosperous. I find unfortunate, because when you are prosperous, like Julian said, you can help other people. You're blessed to be a blessing.
Yeah.
And this conversation that I've stumbled across lately is certain preachers or pastors get boxed in by, you know, people out there on YouTube, people out in the media, talking about their prosperity preachers, their prosperity gospel. To me, I've never really understood that, because when I read the gospel, when I read the Bible, there's prosperity in there.
Oh, yeah.
That this is a specific, you know, line of preaching or religion, the prosperity religion, I think, that what people are trying to get
through. I just think there's people out there are trying to attack. I mean, we know that, listen, one thing that God did promise in his word, that we would be persecuted. And you know what?
Jesus guarantees that.
He guarantees that. But he says, but don't worry about it, because I've overcome the world, right? Like, it's like, who cares? But I will tell you what's really cool is that when you are persecuted, you know that you are right in the will of God, because no one's going to persecute someone that's lukewarm.
Mm-hmm. Well said. Yeah. And then, you know, there's it's unfortunate. There are some people that have taken advantage.
Yeah, but in any business, right?
There's people that take advantage of their position, and they milk people, and they rip them off. Of course, that happens everywhere.
That happens in your business, right?
Happens everywhere. Yeah.
Yeah.
But if you
when it comes to when you say Jesus, OK, now that's a whole other
You're not allowed
story.
To make any money at all, ever. And it's like, you can't do anything. But it's like, I, you know, if people want to like go, well, I can't believe you make all this money. It's like, well, look, you know how hard we work to get to a position where we can do this? You have no idea what we've gone through to get here.
So that we can give
and the sacrifices that we've made to get here. And then you have no idea what we've even given. We never announce our giving. We don't tell people what we give. We don't do anything that, like, but trust me, we do. We have a foundation called Hartman House. We use that to help people out. We help people as much as we can whenever we can. We have to analyze it first, see what it's all about. You know, and then
we'll interesting. A couple of years ago, we were mentoring a couple, and they had just started a ministry. Hmm. And so we were just, you know, going over, you know, all whatever they're going to need to start their ministry. And some. And what was interesting is that we were talking, the money part came into it. And we were talking about the prosperity side of this. And so the gentleman says, well, all I need is this to get by. And I said, okay, really? That's it? Like, only for you? What about all the other people that have a need that you could actually fill that need for them? And he was like, never, he was probably 32 years old, never heard that. This was just a business, you know, meeting where we were mentoring. He goes, I never thought about that. And I said, you're telling me you've never thought about making money to help other people? He said, no, I thought it was just for me. And so what I love about it is that guy's whole life changed, because he wasn't stuck with this thing of like, I only need what I need to get by. And that's all I need. And so, you know, how many cars do you need? How many houses do you need? Yeah. And if you want to have 50 of each, that's your business.
Absolutely.
You're not asking me for a dime. It's your business. Mm-hmm. But if you want to go and help people with that money, man, what a blessing that we can be the feet and the hands of Jesus by paying for people's rent, paying for, like I said, for cars, paying for medical bills, paying for education, whatever it is paying that we
clothing.
Can do.
Clothing. One, the very first thing we ever bought for somebody when we finally started making a little bit of money, this person we knew needed a plane ticket to go see their son. And we're like, how much is the plane? And she couldn't afford it. We're like, how much is the plane ticket? It's like $300. We could do that. And it changed this person's life that we would do that for them. And we're like, wow, we should do that again. That was really fun.
You know, honestly, you wouldn't have met two more selfish people in your life.
Oh, yeah.
Back before we before we got saved, it was like give what to
well,
who?
Here's why. Right? Here's why we were selfish. We were survivors.
Yeah,
we came from homes that were very chaotic.
Wow. We had no money.
We had no money at all growing up. I didn't have any money. We had nothing. And so like when you get, we weren't like this like angry selfish people. We were just like, look, man, I just got to get this for me.
This is mine.
Yeah, you know? and that's the attitude of a lot of people, and we completely understand. We get it. But
when you open up your heart, you open up your hands as well. And you say, listen, he says that he'll supply all your need according to his riches and glory. But if his people don't want to give to, you know, whatever charities or whatever it might be, what's wrong with that picture?
Yeah.
Is your heart open?
Yeah. Let's talk about that because, you know, the time where before Christ, BC, a couple of questions I have, areas of curiosity is, okay, I'm stuck in survivor mode, which sadly, because of the pandemic and the lockdowns, a lot of people have been dependent on church, charity, stimulus checks, you know.
Amen, yes.
Checks, right? And so how do I get out of survivor mode if so many potential opportunities have been taken away from me? I've been locked down. How would you advise somebody to go out there and find out what they can do to get out of survivor mode? Mm. And I have another question after that.
Yeah, yeah. Do you want to answer that one?
Well, I mean, as far as that, there's so many. I tell you what, if you start researching online, we were just, you know, because we're in this business, we're trying to help people, you know, get their business started, their vision started. There are so many programs out there that people don't even know about that the government actually has available. Mm-hmm. And especially we just found out about a couple of them in the SBA.gov, I believe. There's so many different programs for that. But the bottom line is this, the church is supposed to be the one that helps. But we're so, you know, if you are a pastor and you are running a church and if you are speaking truth, you will have people in your church. Mm-hmm. It's the ones that are out there and they're speaking other things, trying to get people in by the flashiness and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. People won't stay because no one wants to ever be lied to or not have the whole truth be told to them. When you tell people the truth, the true gospel, the truth about Jesus, you know, that's a whole different thing than some of the churches that we have that are open and available now. So churches should be out there giving. That is, my gosh, that's how it first started. Yeah. way back.
You know, I want to say what I would say, the advice I would give is I always ask people this, what do you do every day no one has to pay you to do? That's what you should begin to do for a living. You know, do you like to knit? Do you like to cook? Do you like to play music? What did it? You know, I know a lot of these things are very tricky to figure out. And how you can, like, again, going online, just because we're locked in our houses or we're locked in our houses doesn't mean there's not opportunity. There's a lot of people out there made a lot of money during the pandemic and they made a home business. They did this, they did this. Hard work can really pay off in a lot of different ways. We have another book called Vision Possible, where we want to help people. Our slogan is Believe, Conceive, Achieve. And how do you get your vision out there? Where do you even start with a vision? A lot of people that are too young don't know how to get started. Some people that are my age, maybe they started it, maybe it got stopped for whatever reason. How do you pick it back up again? Oh my gosh, I'm too old. I could never do this. We know people at our age that are starting businesses now that are doing fantastic because they put their mind to it. They didn't give up. And I know it's easy to say you want to give up and take the stimulus check. And by the way, I'm not saying not to take
it.
But there's ways you can figure out how to get your vision out there if you really want to.
You know, the reality is, and maybe this is a call out to call up some of the followers that I have on my YouTube channel. I get more people from Nairobi, Ghana, Ukraine, outside the United States of America, DMing me to ask me if they can do some graphic design work for my YouTube channel,
mm-hmm.
for my Instagram. more from outside the United States of America than inside the United States of America. This is the craziest thing. And we're happy to give work.
Of course.
Say, yeah, you know what? If you're going to believe that, no problem. No problem. Keep creating. Philippines, where I'm from, asking for work all the time. So I'm encouraging those who think that there's no opportunity here in America.
Well, there's a young man I know very recently. He didn't have a job. He was having trouble finding work. He likes cars. He started a car detailing business. He's making like thousands of dollars a month now. Now he's doing high-end cars. And it was something he never even thought he would do. And we talked to him. We coached him a little bit. And it's like, well, he finally saw what his niche was. He finally saw what his love was. And he loves doing it. And so there's always a will. I mean, there's always a way, as long as you're willing to explore it, that might be. Some people don't want to do what they have in their heart to do. And they're like, they look at other things as it's a step down. I don't want to go work at that store. I don't want to go do this or do that. But if God's telling you to go somewhere and do something, go do it. And whatever job you get, do it as unto the Lord, the Bible says. I saw this one YouTube video about a Navy SEAL. This guy went through all that Navy SEAL training, all that gnarly stuff they go through. And he finally got the job as a Navy SEAL. And he's like, man, I can't wait. I'm a Navy SEAL. And the first job they gave him was cleaning toilets. And he's cleaning toilets. And he goes, you know what? I clean those toilets like they were. I clean those things so good. And the bosses looked at him. They're like, this guy cleans toilets this good. He's going right up to the top. And they gave him like a huge promotion. Because like when you do that job as good as you can do it, because somebody is watching you.
Always. Always. You know, what I love too is that this is a time where people, I believe that you know, COVID, the whole pandemic of us being locked in, it really pushed out creativity in people. Yeah. And there are more people now that have got skills they didn't even know they had, but because they sat and they searched online, you know, that's why we just love to encourage people, like, I don't care what it is, get online, start researching. There's got to be something that strikes your heart that says, you know what, I think I can do that. There's so many, I mean, I would probably say out of 20 people I know right now that worked in offices, no longer work in offices. They are all working at home, maybe for those companies, but people are now learning how to work at home. They're learning how to time manage, because at first, man, people were at home going, well, I'll just sleep an extra half hour. You know, I'll take a nap during my lunch, you know, and people started realizing, uh-oh, this is not good. This isn't good time management. Yeah. So they really had to like start setting some rules for themselves. But I believe that everybody has got something creative on the inside of them. Yep. There's something that you can do, but don't let your past history or things that anybody said to you make you think that you don't have that on the inside of you.
Especially family history. A lot of us get hung up on family history. Well, we've always done it this way. Well, no one in my family's ever done blank. You've really got to get that. When you're in Christ, you're a new creation. And you're a new branch on the olive tree. Start your own family tree. Start your own branch of a family tree. And do things maybe no one's ever done in your family before. And then help your family. You know, that's what we encourage people to do.
Yeah.
Part of my next part of that question is, you know, you're there in LA and you are believers, but the rest of LA may not be so much believers, right? So how do you go about, when you guys were new to the Lord, you didn't come from a bring of following the Lord, and as many people that follow this channel, I didn't come from. So how do you not only start getting fixed yourself, but how do you start working together as a couple? Because in the process of you fixing yourself, you're also working on your marriage.
Well, I'm just thankful that we both came to Christ at around the same time. And we both wanted to learn, because we both knew that we'd seen examples in our lives that weren't working, of other things in our lives that weren't working, other individuals. We're like, you know, that didn't work. What can we do differently that can work?
We're not going to repeat history.
And the main thing we wanted, that where it all started, we wanted to have a house of peace. We wanted peace in our house. Because again, like I said, we came from very chaotic upbringings. And I'm like, I want a house of peace. And no matter what price we have to pay for that peace, we're going to pay it. If that means going to church six times a week, that's what we're doing. If that means opening up the Bible instead of turning on the news, that's what we're doing. We are going to commit ourselves to this, because that's what peaceful people do. We're going to learn this. And then it became a way of life. It just became a way of life. And that's what anybody with a new mindset has to do. You have to put the new wine into a new wineskin. You need to renew your mind. The Bible says in Romans, it's the renewing of your mind. It's a constant process of renewal. It's not a renewed mind one time only.
No.
Renewing sure wish it every was. Day.
Yeah. I mean, I was 37 years old when I became a Christian.
You told me you were 27.
No. Okay. Well, you're just unveiling. I'm 10 years older. I'm sorry.
Sorry.
But I knew nothing about Jesus. Like I said, he was a cuss word. Me so neither. I knew nothing. And this really sweet church that we went to was down in Los Angeles, and
South
it
Central
was
LA. I heard
South Central. Yeah. South and they did me the biggest favor. They put a Bible in my hand and said, you need to follow along with what the pastor's saying. And so they gave us cassettes back then. That's how we're dating ourselves. Yes, but yes. They gave us cassettes and we went home and we, you know, play it, listen, play it back, listen, follow along in the Bible, because Dr. Price was an amazing teacher. And so he would, we could
it was
really,
Crenshaw Christian Center.
Yeah, we could really follow along. Imagine, you know nothing about this at all. But one way that we handle living in LA, being Christians, is we love people. No one, it's very rare that someone goes, no, you can't love me. You know, people, they may act like it, but they want it so bad. And we have a Bible study we do on Wednesday nights at our offices in Calabasas. We started during the pandemic, Church in the Park in Woodland Hills. And we are seeing, oh my gosh, I can't even tell you.
We're seeing some real
miracles.
Chains fall off people.
Oh, like people trauma leaving people in such a strong way now. And I feel this way that, you know, I'm born and raised here. There's no other place for me to be. This is my place. This is my Butchie's been here so long. He's like, you know, almost.
She called me Butchie.
Sorry.
So you guys should call me that too if you want to.
But you know, he's been here for
Butchie.
What's up?
But he's been here so long that, you know, he's pretty much a Californian.
I've been here 37 years.
Yeah. But this is who I know. These are my people. I was once not a Christian. I understand. I get all of that. Mm-hmm. So we're not going anywhere. We're staying here and we're loving people, but we're not going to not tell them the truth.
You know, if somebody's watching this, they say, okay, I want the Lord or this relationship with the Lord, and the Lord's going to inspire me to just do great work. But now, you know, there's that saying, pray like it's up to God, but work like it's up to you. You know, that little cliche saying there. So if I am inspired by Butch, I'm inspired by Julie, I'm inspired by your work, and want to be the next thing, and I want to start a YouTube channel, I want to start a TikTok, and I want to start getting creative. Give me some what's some daily practicality? Is it content schedule they got to worry about? Is it the pre-prep work they got to do before they hit publish? What would that body of work be like, Butch?
I'm just so excited. We just hit 1.2 million on TikTok, which I love. TikTok. What I love about TikTok, though, I've been on YouTube since 2015, and I'm almost to a million. I got on TikTok a little over a year ago, and already got to 1.2 million. TikTok is one of the fastest growing social media platforms out there.
He loves it.
It's a blast, because it's easy to make and super fun. You can interact with your fans, but there's over 850 million active users on TikTok right now. That's not even counting China. That's just counting the rest of the world. What I would do is this. I wouldn't worry about right now. If you're brand new to all these things, don't worry about scheduling. Don't worry about all the analytics. Just start making some stuff. Make a YouTube video.
You want to make?
Yeah.
What intrigues you? What is funny to you?
What do you like? Do you like science fiction? Do
you
like dancing?
Teach?
Do you like, is your dog your best friend? I mean, I don't know what it is. Make a video, put it up, see what happens, and make another one.
You know,
let me just say one more thing. I will say this. All of these platforms, YouTube, TikTok, Facebook, Instagram, they all depend on the algorithm. You got to keep feeding the algorithm. You need to post constantly. It doesn't mean 16 times a day. If you want to, you can. Post once or twice a week to start. Don't freak out. And just see what people say. I guarantee you there's an audience out there for you. What were you going to say?
We've coached many people on starting their YouTube channel because they really don't. I mean, here's what happens. This is pretty much 3/4 of the people. They're so excited. They're so gung-ho. They do 10. And then they're like, I have no more energy to do more than that. Like, I got to keep feeding this. And we're like, we told you that in the beginning.
It's a grind.
You just don't. Yeah, you don't just.
Get started.
Find out though, what is your niche? What do you love? Because you're not going to do something for the next 10 years of what you don't love. You know, we met a girl just a couple of weeks ago in Hawaii, and her dog is like famous. And it just started because
her dog kind of talks. It'll be like, you'll say, I forget the dog's name. It's like, hey, Billy, how you doing? He go like, and like make like little dog human noises. And it's like, you're talking like 10 million
and
followers.
She just put it on for like, to make people laugh. Well, now the dog has his own brand.
But with the followers comes influence. That's why they're called influencers. Now you now have a platform. You can sell stuff. You can tell people stuff. You can ask people stuff. And that's what it's all about. What type of influence do you want to put out there? What type of influence do you want to be known for? And what do you want to give back to the world that's given you so much? You know, if the world's given you something, what do you want to give back? For me, the joy for me is when I was at Nickelodeon, and we were limited by technology back then. You put a show on TV, they'd run a couple commercials. Hopefully people watch. I would always say, can we run some more commercials? Yeah, we're running some commercials. I never had control over it. But now I make something, I can talk about it right away to a whole bunch of people. I can show people behind the scenes. I can give them all. I just posted something today. Actually, we were talking. It's the day in the life of a cartoon creator. What do we do every day? It's a TikTok. It's a minute long. And it's the first minute is what I do. And then we'll go into the second minute. And it's like a little condensed video, but it's just super fun to do.
You know, when you've got someone that wants to create, you know, some kind of a persona on one of these platforms, get your friends together. Have your friends tell you who you are.
Yeah.
That really, we love doing that because usually, obviously, the influencer is going to be one person. So we're like, so let me, what about you? Tell me about yourself. They usually can't tell you about themselves.
Like you're the money guy. You're doing this because you love money. I mean, don't we all? But like, you love talking about it. You love success. You love
to help people make
money. You like helping people make money, especially Christian people. So that's a real, there's your niche. You're like, you're this. There's all these little adjectives we're adding to your list. And so that's when you find out what you're all about. There's one guy I watch on TikTok who I absolutely love. He cooks weird recipes. He goes, he'll go like, a chocolate molasses cake from 1910. He reads these old recipes and he'll make the recipe. And at the end, he tastes it. It's just really funny. He's got 3 million followers, you know, and you're like, what the heck? So,
but you know, when we do through Vision Possible, which is our coaching platform, the Mad Hustle book and the coaching. And also we have a podcast that we do every week. That's all through Vision Possible. But what we love to do is when someone does come into what we call a business accelerator or a creative accelerator, we get their, if they come in by themselves, we get their parents on the phone. We get, you know, sisters, brothers, we get friends, whoever they are. And they say, tell me about Joe, you know, or tell me about, like, I'd get your wife on the phone. No one knows you better than your wife.
Yeah. What does Matt like to do?
What's Matt love to do? Because Matt may have a whole different perspective of himself. But your wife is looking at you from a different direction, and she can help you bring out a lot of the qualities that maybe you didn't even realize that you had that would be very successful when you implement them.
Why don't we do this? For those of you watching this right now on YouTube, put in the section below, what is your area of creativity? What is your area that you love to express? Would you like time with the Hartmans? Would you like to spend time with Butch? And you guys don't know I'm doing this right now, but I don't know what exactly your packages are, what your time is worth, but I like to find a way to scholarship somebody who doesn't have the means to do so to spend some time with you both.
Awesome.
Therefore, they can express that and find out somehow, some way, and we launch and give birth to the next big giants and giantess.
Yeah, I'll tell you this too, Matt. You can scholarship somebody. We'll even offer a scholarship to somebody who wants, for one person who really is dedicated. They got to be dedicated.
Yeah.
And they want to do this because we don't offer these things for free very often, simply because our time is valuable as well. And the time we spend with you is such high quality time. We are going to pull stuff out of you that you probably won't even realize.
You
will
be exhausted.
You'll be exhausted, but we're going to get you to that gate. But we'll give you all of our info.
And we do that for businesses too. And what I love is that, you know, we do this to ourselves. Matter of fact, when the pandemic hit, we were actually in Hawaii. And
March of 2020,
day that everything shut down. And I remember getting some water at the airport. And so someone in front of me said, hey, I heard the whole world shutting down for 2 weeks. And I went, we'll go back to my seat. I'm like, sweetie, some guy said that everything is going to shut down for 2 weeks. We're like, yeah, right.
Sure.
But I will tell you though, that next week we said we're not going to fail in this whatsoever.
We're going to increase in this.
And so we went back in our warehouse. We took out what we do for everybody else for this accelerator, what we call, and we did it on ourselves for every business that we run. And we spent weeks doing that and perfecting and strategizing. Yeah. And because it's, you have to keep doing that. You can't just put one thing out there and not feed it anymore. Be like, you had the baby. Okay, baby, take care of yourself now. You know, that doesn't happen.
You know, Proverbs 18:21 says death and life are in the power of the tongue. And so whatever you say is what's going to happen. I mean, really, it's almost like a magic trick. I'm not saying it is a magic trick, but it's what you say. Your words are very, very powerful. Yes. And so if you say, this is going to ruin us, that's probably the way you're going to start going. If you say, though, no, I'm going to win in this scenario. I don't know how yet, but we're going to succeed here. We're going to advance. Somehow we're going to advance. It's your attitude. And we teach people about that as well.
Yep.
Amen. Before we wrap up, guys, any final thoughts? Obviously, we're going to be putting all your description links here in the lower third, and if not in the description of this YouTube video. But any final thoughts here? If I was to ask you this one last question, if somebody out there is watching and say, you know what, I want to go about my life and I see wealth and success and prosperity, but I want to do it God's way. I want to do it based on a faith-based, Bible-based way. If I want to be a millionaire, I want to make sure I'm doing it a faith-based, Bible-based way. If I want to go out there and be the next big studette on Nickelodeon or whatever networking that you want on your own YouTube channel, I want to do it in a faith-based, Bible-based way. What words of wisdom would you give them, Hartmans?
Well, number one is don't conform to this world. What are you? What's unique about you? And what do you want to portray? Because you know, the word is when you are on YouTube, even when you have a TV show or whatever it might be, you are an influencer. That means you're influencing somebody and you're probably influencing many, the masses. What do you want to influence them with? And that's really what it comes down to. You know, listen, God is there to help you do whatever. He is the helper, right? He wants to help you. The Holy Spirit's the helper. He wants to help you through doing whatever it is that you've been called to do. Why? Because he's called you to do it. So he's there for every step of the way. So you can't forget that. Don't ever think that you might feel alone. You might feel that you're isolated. But if you've got Christ in you, you've got the presence of the Holy Spirit 24/7. He says, I'll never leave you or forsake you. I am here and I will help you. I will give you. You talk to me and we share those moments, those intimate times together. I'll give you the plan. I'll give you the steps to take. And that's what we have to do. And I will tell you the biggest thing that you could do for yourself if you are a CEO or you're just starting out in your own company, you're the only employee. The time you spend in prayer will benefit your company no matter what. I don't care. You can have brainstorming meetings all day long and they can be really funny and great. But the time you spend with the Lord is where action's going to take place. Mm. That's number one important. Don't start your day without having conversation and having the word of God in your mouth, speaking it out, because the word of God is alive and it's sharp and it's quick. And so if you're not speaking that out, then you're probably speaking something else that might you know, deter you.
Amen.
I'm supposed to follow
that. Yeah, go ahead. Follow that.
No, you know what I'm going to do? I'm just going to show you a Spider-Man drawing. How about that? There's some Spider-Man for you. There you go. No. No, I told you to show you some drawings. I haven't done it yet. No, you know what, dude? I would just say this. I can't follow it. That was amazing. I just say Matthew 6:33, seek the kingdom first and all these things will be added unto you. You know what? If you're in Hollywood, no matter where you are, pray, like she said, read your Bible, get into the word and those creative ideas. You've already got one. We serve a creative God. You're made in his image. You have creativity, but learn how the business works. And that is the key. Whatever business it is, learn how it works. That's going to be number one. So yeah, but I thought that was great. Well done.
Amen. For those of you watching this on YouTube, if you are seeking the Lord, if you're seeking the kingdom first, put in a comment section, I am seeking the kingdom first. I am seeking the kingdom first. And I can't tell you what this multiplier factor is. As suspected, with Bill, Butch, and Julianne, that my multiplied conversation with other fellow believers is like this. I can talk to them forever. Next thing you know, time just flies by. And Butch and Julianne, I just can't tell how much I'm honored to have this conversation with you, to know that you are making such an impact for the Lord. You're making an impact there in an area where the Lord seems to not be hanging out very, very much, especially in show business, especially in business, period. But I'm just excited and delighted to know you both.
The one thing I'll add to that real fast, I won't take too much time. The one thing, the Lord is hanging out in the entertainment business. It's just a lot of Christians don't want to be in it because we're afraid of it. We've been scared away from the entertainment business, and it's time to get back in. So I just want to say that it's time to get back in and
it's time for the church to support the you know, there's a lot of kids out there because we meet them and we talk with them. They're super creative, but their families are, you know, they say that's all of the devil. And I'm not saying that, you know, there's some crazy stuff that happens in Hollywood. We see it, right? But when you've got a child, a brother, a sister, whoever, that is so creative, but you've taught them that that's all bad and dark and horrible, you forget there are people out there like us that aren't that. There's a lot of people in Hollywood that aren't that way.
Yeah.
Yes, when you come with no money, no plan, by yourself, that could get in a lot of trouble, which that happened to me. And I lived here when I was 18, when I wanted to be an actress. That happened to me and I was from here. So I know there's a dark side to it. But when the church looks at it and says, you know, stay away from those people, you don't support us. And then you complain about how you don't like programming, but you're not willing to support the people that could change and enhance some of the programming. So you got to stop complaining because it's not fair. If you're not going to help and support these kids and these people that are creative, that were like given this kind of creativity, and you don't like the programming, then stop watching because it's your fault. Oh, that was harsh.
Yeah, that's it. Hey, it's a call out to call up. We need to raise our standard. The church needs to raise its standards. As believers need to raise the standards. And I stay corrected. You're right. The Lord is around. It's just not people calling him.
Amen.
Yes.
Involved.
So, guys, I didn't even have a chance to ask Bush to whoop up his drawing pad today. I did ask
him. Oh, he's got so much.
Well, instead of drawings, it would take me just a little bit to draw. I got a bunch of drawings here I could show you. Here's a Hulk. There's an incredible Hulk. There's that. And then I have, wait.
This is when he's just doodling.
Here's a Wolverine. There's a Wolverine and Spider-Man and some X-Men there. I got that there.
How long does it take you to do that? How long does it take to actually sketch?
Oh, that's like maybe that was like 30 minutes because there's many characters. Here's Invincible. Have you watched Invincible yet on Amazon? There's Invincible. And then I got a bunch of anime. Oh, here's another Wolverine I did. There's Wolverine there.
He didn't shave.
I know. Yeah, I know exactly. here's an anime. We're talking about the Lord, but here's a show called Demon Slayer. This is a guy from Demon Slayer.
Yes. Those eyebrows, man.
But, man. I know. But you can see all these drawings on my TikTok. I draw them and I do like a time lapse. So you can see that stuff. It's just fun to do. So if I'm drawing now, I just do a TikTok of it. It's always a blast. And if you got any suggestions for me, what you want to see, let me know. We'll see if we can get it worked out for you.
Also, one cool thing is that HarperCollins commissioned him to do a children's Bible. And so we've been working on that now for a year. And we've got it's so great. Because
That'll be out next, either Christmas or Easter of next year. Yeah. Or this Christmas.
This Christmas or next Easter.
Yeah.
But it was like, it was a no-brainer for us. We're like, wow, if we can sew into the lives of children for the next, God knows, until Jesus comes back.
That's a big responsibility.
What a blessing that is. So it's been a lot of fun for him.
Well, I guess I have a permanent Christmas present every year.
Kids in our family, Bibles.
If you're watching this on YouTube, guys, make sure you drop your feedback, your thoughts, your questions, your follow-ups in the comment section below. If you are watching this on Facebook, make sure you click like and follow our business page, Money Smart Guy. And if you're watching this on YouTube, make sure you click subscribe and hit notifications to be alerted the next time we upload our next episode. With that being said, guys, Julianne, Butch, you guys have been so giving of your time today. Thank you for blessing the Seven Fear Squad YouTube channel community.
Well, it's our honor to be here. Thank you guys.
So much. I'll
bless you to your audience. If we can help anybody out there, just let us know.
For sure. With that being said, guys, on behalf of the Hartmans, I'm your Money Smart Guy. And until we meet again, continue to live smart, and be money smart today. God bless you guys.